Thanks a lot for this kind introduction. Also, thanks for inviting me. First question, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, that is already very good. Yeah, then as you see, I would like to speak a little bit about spatial processes or processes in space and time. I have to apologize for this little addition here. I mean, mostly I give talks in front of biologists, and biologists are often a little bit afraid of math, and that's why one has to say, I'm very sorry, but we cannot really explain what we want to explain if we don't use math. But I think in this audience here, it's of course understood that this is what we need. As Elisabeth already said, I'm heading a group for theoretical biophysics at the university, at Humboldt University in Berlin. Despite the fact that the group is called theoretical biophysics, we also have an experimental lab. So we do a number of the experiments that I will show you later in our own lab, because it has turned out that it's extremely important to have your own data in hand and to really go and do the experiments as you want them to do, and really also know all the, let's say, kind of metadata around an experiment. So under which temperatures has something been measured? What are the little tricks that has somebody used in order to really get the data out of the experiments that they are showing at the end? And that's why for us it was very useful and also somehow crucial to have an own lab where we can do the experiment. Also that a student who is actually doing a model all the time can think about, how can I go and test what I'm doing? So just to have that in mind also, not only think about the theory, but have the testing in mind. And in many cases it happens that people just do the calculations first, then go down in the lab, try to do some experiments, and then go back and use their own data. Okay, and what I would like to talk about today, as I said, is space and time, because what is really clear is that all the networks that we look at in biology are, of course, fine for some kind of moment, but as soon as the biological object somehow changes, that also influence the processing of the network. Yeah? For example, if you think about a metabolic network or so, if a cell is growing or maybe under some circumstances shrinking, then suddenly the same, the whole thing happens under different spatial limitations in different size, so concentrations, for example, immediately change. But there's a lot of other things where space really makes a difference, and that's why I would like to start with a few examples, not from our own lab, but also from other groups, to just motivate why it might be interesting to look at space, and then I will introduce a little bit some of the concepts, and then we will go on with more examples from my group. Please, if there's any question arising, just ask, also in between. I mean, for me, it's not really necessary to get to the end of everything, so we can also start discussing things in between. If not, then you can wait to the end. Okay. The first thing I would like to say as an example, there is a group of Petra Schwille. She is now in Munich, and she is looking already for many years at a system in E. coli that helps E. coli cells during the division to find the center of their cell. So that is somehow a representation of the cell. And as you can see, it's a little bit like a rod. And when they grow, they get a bit longer and bigger. But then they want to divide here exactly in the middle to give more or less exactly the same daughter cells. It's also not really exactly the same, because one of the sites here is already the one where they had divided before, and this was a growing site before, but they are roughly dividing equally, and that's why they must find the middle system. And what they use is a system of some proteins here, min D, min E, and they oscillate between the poles of the cells, and then they somehow form a gradient so that in the minimum is here in the middle, and then another set of protein knows where it has to assemble here, this FTSZ, and then they form some kind of ring, and then they can divide. And in this work, that is where I just took these pictures of, they thought they can also, let's say, minimize or reduce the system a little bit that is responsible for this process in order to find other patterns of spatial behavior. So that would be when they use the set of proteins that is responsible and just cultivate them in vitro and start to activate them, then you can see that we see here some pattern formation in this in vitro system in two dimensions here. And what they have found out, if they reduce this a little bit, so if they don't allow dimers, or here in this case, tetramers, then we have no gradient formation. If they have just a dimer and one other component, then we see this kind of spirals, dimer and dimerization of this component, we see another pattern, and so on. So that means that depending on the compounds that we have and their abilities to interact, we can see different patterns in space at the end. And here's a little bit just a representation of the compounds that are involved here. As I said, there is this so-called MinD that has to bind to the membrane. It uses ATP, then it binds another component, MinC. Then MinE somehow allows dephosphorylation by binding here, and then it gets released, released again. And so as you see, that is already some kind of network. It's a number of processes that are going on, but it's very clearly that we have some processes that are going on here, more or less in the cytosol, and other processes where we really need the membrane as a location for these processes. And then at the end, as we see it here, that would be in vivo. What we saw on the slide before was in vitro, but here we see, okay, for one point in time, we have an accumulation of these proteins on one side of the cell, and then a little bit later on the other side of the cell. And if we would proceed with that, then we would see here a higher concentration, there a higher concentration, and the minimum in the middle where this FTS set can then build. So that is the first, let's say, example for the fact that we need a network of molecular interactions on one side, but also the physical boundaries, the space of the cell on the other side. So this is a completely different kind of example. This is tumor cells, or the kind of cell line that people have in their labs used to mimic tumor cells. And what we can see here is that these cells like to migrate if there is space available. And there's a number of different experiments that one can do to force them to migrate. What we see here is a hole, and here you see this as a movie. When you put a hole into this culture, then they invade this, and this is the alternative, that one has a scratch, and they start to move into this space. And that's not only because the cells divide and simply require more space, because it's a because of the division, that is really some movement into this open space. And I think that Jana will speak a little bit later about signaling pathways in cells. Of course, a lot of signaling pathways in the cells are involved in that. So the cells really take different cues from the environment to learn what the environment is, whether there's another a neighboring cell or some kind of stimulus, growth factor, or so on, and then they have a directed, not really directed, but in effect, it's a directed motion into this open space here. And here, this is another example, in this case, from our group. As I said, we are looking at yeast cells in a lot of different conditions. And this is now the question a little bit, what the fate of different mRNAs are. So mRNA, as you know, is, let's say, somehow the messenger from the genetic material to the protein, but it's not, it can have, of course, also have many more functions, and one function that we speculated a little bit about is, can it play a role in the cell sensing that it is, let's say, has enough metabolic capacity to live on its own? So what we have here somehow symbolized is a mother cell and the daughter cell that is forming. I will come back again and again to the fact that the daughter cell is a little bit smaller than the mother. Yeah, so it's just like a, not like an E. coli that we have seen before. E. coli is growing and then it divides in the middle. The yeast starts as a somehow bigger cell, and then it forms a smaller cell that is growing until it can be divided. And the question is, how does a smaller unit now know, yes, I'm strong enough to live on my own, I have enough metabolic capacity? And one idea would be that mRNA molecules move through the cell, and what you see here, this one, this part is the bigger mother cell, that is a smaller daughter cell. The red thing here is a so-called butt neck, so there are some proteins really at the discrimination here between these two things. And the blue shiny thing here is the nucleus that is trying to go through. And the green dots have now been recorded with a light sheet microscopy. That is different mRNA molecules of one specific type. It's a protein called Klipp2 that is important in the second phase of the cell cycle. And what we speculated already in some modeling approach is that this Klipp2 actually somehow gets transported into the bud in order to be translated only in the bud, or primarily in the bud, to tell the cell, yes, if I have enough Klipp2, that means there was enough capacity for all this translation, and so, yes, I'm strong enough to live on my own. Okay, good. So, as I said, we would like to talk more about yeast. Here are some yeast molecules under the microscope. It's a very nice model system because, first of all, it's unicellular, so you can really look at every single cell separately. It's a eukaryotic cell, so that means it's a little bit like us. So it has a nucleus, it has mitochondria. So we can also compare a lot of things. Of course, not everything. Yeast is still a little bit special. It's extremely well studied, so a lot of information that is available is in databases. One knows a lot of things. Most genes have a name and a function. Of course, still not all of them. I mean, they have like 6,000 genes, and I think 4,500 or so one assumes to know what they are doing. But as I said, it's really different also to some extent. It has a cell wall, and I will come back to that. You might guess it a little bit here. It has a cell wall more or less like a plant cell that also gives it a little bit the shape, and it allows it also to have inside bit higher pressure. And as I already mentioned, it divides asymmetrically by forming this little bud that then can grow. And as I said, in my group, we really try now to, let's say, make models more or less for all the different processes that we can see in the cell. So we are very interested in the temporal behavior. So we look at the cell cycle, so all the machinery that is necessary for the cell to really progress through all the division processes, organize that the DNA is replicated and that all the machinery is available then. We have models for the transport processes, for the ion transport, for the nutrient transport. We have models for the growth, for the mother and for the bud. We have models for all the different signaling pathways. Hawk is for osmotic stress response. MAT is mating. We will come to that in a minute. Calcineurin signaling, TOR pathways, more or less for nutrient sensing. We have models for gene expression, transcription, translation, assembly of protein complexes, histone, and metabolism, all the different ways. And as you might imagine, there is not just one model formalism that fits all the different questions that one can have there. So we use a lot of different model formalisms, of course, mostly, in most cases, ordinary differential equations, but also Boolean networks, rule-based models. And since space often really is important, we also now go to spatial modeling with partial differential equations on the one hand side, or also simpler things. And at the end, as it said here, we all want to use base set on the data that we can get. It should be quantitative, it should be dynamic, yeah, and predictive. As I said, we can go down to the lab and try to test what we see. So since I said we want to look at things now in space, I have to challenge you now with just a few equations. For some of you, it might be just very basic stuff, but because I don't know really what the background of you is, I just would like to repeat a few things. So what we need for the simulation in space is, of course, first of all, that we should look at the thermodynamic basis of the whole thing. So we need some nonlinear thermodynamics and some balance equation. The first thing is we have to look at the biochemical reactions just alone. So what we would have if Ci is a concentration of some component I change over time, then we can look at this change of the concentration, which is given on the one hand by the different rates, that is here indicated with a W, by the stoichiometric coefficients. I would guess if Julio has been here, he has also explained that. Maybe not. So we have all the different reactions that a component can undergo, maybe binding to another component, production, degradation, and so on, and this is the stoichiometric coefficient here. If we then also might have mechanical motion within that system, so that these components not only react as such, but also can diffuse, then we have to include also the diffusion term here. So that is, this V is a velocity times the concentration. Velocity times the concentration is then a flux. And here we have the divergence of that flux that also has to be considered if we look at these changes over time and the reactions here. Another important expression that had been derived is already quite old and classic, the so-called Nernst-Planck equation. That is, if we also have some electrodiffusion included. So we would have now this flux of the component that we also have already used here. That is then somehow related on the one hand to the mobility of the compound, or this whole thing together would be the diffusion constant, the change in space, the local change of that compound. Here again we have the mobility, the charge of the compound, Faraday's constant, and the electrical field in that can. That means if we have charged compounds like ions or other charged compounds, then we can also calculate these fluxes here from this kind of Nernst equation. We have again the Nernst equation, and as I said, yeah, we have this is U times R times T is a diffusion constant that is also will be also relevant then later in the other parts that I will talk about. So if you have no electric field, only diffusion, and also no chemical reactions, then one can also, of course, derive the diffusion equation, which we have here. So that assumes that the diffusion constant is constant, but we also will assume all the time, yeah, so that we have the diffusion equation. That means the change of a concentration over time can be related to the change or the second derivative here of the concentration with respect to space times the diffusion constant, or if we are in three dimensions, then of course we have the Laplace operator here. So that is a little bit the background. And if we now combine both again, that we look at diffusion and biochemical reactions together, then we see that we have this change of a compound. I mean, this is the compound at some point in space and time changes by the diffusion times Laplace of the concentration and by all these different reactions that we have in that system. So that's what we want to use. Here just a few examples. I mean, if we would have this little set of equations here just in one dimension that would be here, maybe it's hard to see from the back, it's x. If we would have x, then we have to, of course, set some kind of parameter values here, for example, at the beginning, no degradation or consumption and a small diffusion constant. Then we would need to set some boundary conditions, of course, if we want to simulate this, for example, that at T0, always all values are zero, for x equal to zero, everything is zero, and here for x equal to five is five. Then we see we get some distribution of the compound over space and time. If we would now, for example, start having some degradation here, which it actually is some degradation, then we would see, of course, here then the shape of that space changes a little bit. We can also look what would happen if we now, okay, now this is confined here to the three edges. If we would now either have some kind of production of that compound over time, then we see the concentration that we have plotted here is going higher and higher. If we have some degradation, because in total that would be some degradation, then the concentration is getting lower. But this is only one-dimensional. We could also impose some trigonometric functions here. Then, of course, we would see that this somehow also fades out over time, depending on the value of our production degradation term, or it also continues over time in that system. And diffusion, also the value of the diffusion also plays a role. If we have very low diffusion, then some kind of condition imposed on the system will also remain for a longer time. If you have very high diffusion, then these kind of conditions more or less fade out very quickly for the system. Good, one more little issue is the different kind of boundary conditions that one can formulate for the system. There's one is a so-called Dirichlet condition, specifies the value that a solution needs to take along the boundary of a domain. Yeah, so for example, if that would be here the boundary of the domain, then the Dirichlet condition says that here is always some kind of fixed value. As it's said here, it might be some a or some function of x, but this value is just here, it always is fixed. Different to that is a so-called von Neumann condition. That's a condition where we set the flux over the boundary here. Yeah? So it's not that there is a fixed value here, but there's a fixed flux that we give to the system. And that, let's say, has a little bit different implication, but also it's suited for different conditions that we consider. And you will see a little bit later that is also relevant for what we wanted to understand. Good, I think that's enough with the introduction. To the mathematical part, we will come back to some of the things. Now I would like to explain a little bit more how our yeast lives and where space really is important at that point. As I said, the yeast really goes to some kind of life cycle and cell cycle, first of all. So normally it starts here as a small daughter cell or so, then it's growing until it's get a bit bigger, and then this bud starts to emerge, this little daughter cell here. And during this time, they have a lot of things to do. As it says here, you have to duplicate the so-called spindle pole body. Later, they have to replicate the DNA. And then at some point, when it's all okay, then the nucleus has to be distributed more or less between the two daughters, and finally it gets divided. That's all fine, and normally the yeast cell is diploid like we, so a double set of chromosomes. If they are under stress, they can do meiosis. And that means they divide into two cells with only one set of chromosomes, and then they sporulate again. And so in this so-called ascus, they could live for a long time. So if you go to the shop and buy some dry yeast, then it's essentially what you can get here. So they can live there without for a long time without any problems. And what we have here now is two types of so-called MATA and two types of MAT alpha cells. And when situation becomes better, when it's wet and warm, then they try to germinate. Both of them can also replicate in the same way as here, completely independent of each other, but somehow being diploid is better for the cells, so they want to unite again to form a diploid cell again. They want, I mean, I say they want, but that's what we just observe. So what do they do to find each other? I mean, if they are really close in their ascus, it's obviously not really a problem to find each other. But if you put them in solution in the lab, then it's a problem to find each other, and then they have to do something. And what they do is that they secrete a so-called pheromone. That's the same thing that also we have pheromones to find each other. The alpha cells secrete the so-called pheromone alpha factor, and the A cells secrete A factor. And as you see, they have receptors for the pheromone on the other side. So when they feel, when they somehow smell there's a mating partner around, they can then, oops, we have secrets here, they can grow toward each other. So into the direction of the pheromone that we have. And here's a little bit a representation of that whole process. So assume that would be the membrane of the cell. In the cell, there is some, and the membrane is some kind of receptor, and that receptor can then bind the pheromone, and it gets activated. And this, what is symbolized here, is another heterotrimeric protein, which undergoes also some complicated processes. And when this whole thing is, gets activated, it actually can do two different things. On the first hand, and can activate the so-called MAP kinase cascade for signal transduction. So that cascade then goes down to the nucleus and tells the nucleus, look, there's a mating partner around, we have to do different things. And these different things is, first of all, prepare for this mating. Means they have to stop their cell cycle, they have to produce some compounds, and they make themselves growing. So that's all hidden behind this little arrow. And the other thing is polarization. And that means there will be more proteins coming here to the membrane, bind here, and at the end form some kind of spot where the cell knows that is the direction in which I have to grow. But we will come back to this. Okay, and then, yeah, when that happens, they start grow towards each other in this kind of shape, and that has been called shmoo. Shmoo, shmoo is actually some kind of comic figure from some kind of American comic that looks more or less like this one, and people have called it like this, and that's now really had entered the scientific literature, so one can simply call it shmoo. Good. One secret that I didn't tell you yet, and it's somehow indicated here, but not completely. I told you that they have to exchange this pheromone. One is secreting alpha pheromone, the other one is secreting alpha pheromone. They would flood the whole environment with their pheromones. That's why the A cells are also secreting a protease that is cleaving that pheromone. So that is exactly counterbalancing or counteracting this. And we will see this on the some slides. So what we see here is now a movie where we have cells. And for now and in the later movies, we will also always color the MAT alpha cells in red and the MAT A cells in green. So you see this is here a lot of alpha cells. Here's A cells. They try to find each other. And when we see this kind of mixture of the two different colors, or that it's getting yellow more or less, then they really manage to mate and to form a new zygote so that they can then continue to live as a diploid. And here, that's what happens if we don't have that protease. Yeah, as I told you, when the protease is not there, then they get a little bit bigger, and then they somehow have a problem of finding the mating partner. Okay, so now based on that, there's a number of questions that one could look at. For example, the first question is, what is actually the stimulus? Yeah, when the cell is supposed to change its shape, what is it actually sensing? It's not so easy to say. Then how is the stimulus sensed? So how do the cells really polarize? How do they respond? So how do they actually form that shape? And also, in between, we can ask what is the optimal information transfer in that system. Okay, let's start with what are they sensing? That question is not so easy to answer. Of course, I said we have a lab, so we could just go and measure this alpha factor. But the problem is the alpha factor is so small, it's a little peptide of 13 amino acids. It somehow escapes all our trials to mark it somehow in the solution, so one cannot really see it. Yeah, there is already tricks now with some kind of click chemistry. Nothing has really worked. So we need some kind of alternative to do this. And what we have done is that we have first somehow selected our cells. Here it says elutriation. Elutriation is one way of selecting only very small cells, and now we assume that this is cells just in the beginning of their cell cycle, so when they would just be, let's say, short before ready to mate, actually. And then we looked at them under the microscope. The first is we looked at some cells where we have deleted. Now we always only look at cells, at the MATA cells. We look at the cells where we have deleted this protease, which is called BAR1, and then stimulate them with certain amounts of alpha factor and get some kind of calibration curve. This, what we see here in green, is actually one protein that only gets produced after they have sensed this alpha factor. So here we really see what they are sensing. Then we looked at the wild type, and when we have the wild type, of course, BAR1 is already cleaving some of the alpha factor. And we see then what the effect would be when we consider this cleavage of the alpha factor. So we see what the effect of BAR1 actually is. And then we have mixed the populations, MAT-A and MAT-alpha, so that now it's really they only can sense what the wild-type MAT-alpha cells are secreting. We have looked at them under bright field, and we looked at them where we record the green fluorescence, the red fluorescence, and then we can combine this so that we really see where is the sender, where are the receivers. And from that information, we try to calculate what the profile of the alpha factor is between those cells. So where do we actually really have alpha factor? And here we now use these kind of mathematical concepts that I just tried to introduce. We have the change of the alpha factor, which is here now in space and time. We have the diffusion constant of the alpha factor, the diffusion of alpha. We have some degradation rate constant. Degradation is due to the activity of the protease BAR1. And here we have the alpha factor itself. And BAR1, of course, can also diffuse, but BAR1, of course, it's secreted, but it's not degraded at any point, at least. We wouldn't know it, but it can diffuse. And since alpha factor gets secreted by the MAT-alpha cells, we have a constant flow of this alpha factor out of these cells. So that means we use this von Neumann boundary condition, where we have a secretion here. We have the secretion here out of the MAT-alpha cells over these membranes. And then, of course, MAT-alpha, when it is hitting the surface of the A cells, as I said, there is this receptor, it gets also internalized, so it means it also gets a little bit sucked out of this environment here that we have. And what else do we know? Alpha factor also it would flow out of the computational domain that we have here, so that is also seen. And the same also holds for BAR1. If BAR1 is hitting here this outer domain, it just flows out of that. So that is the condition that we have. So we calculate the distribution of these different compounds, taking the cells also as some kind of boundaries for the components and let that diffuse. Okay, and that is here just one of the examples or two of the examples for some image that has been taken. So again, this is just the image as it comes out of the microscope, MAT-alpha cells, some MAT-A cells, and then this is the calculated distribution of the pheromone around these cells. As you see here, where we have the MAT-alpha cells, there is a relatively high concentration of alpha factor somehow around them, and we also see that we have a nice gradient here. And the second case is that we have cells where this protease BAR1 has been deleted. So they are still secreting alpha factor, but they are not secreting the protease anymore. And what we then see here that is around those cells that are secreting alpha factor, there's pheromone, but it's all over the place. So it secretes so much pheromone that the concentration is extremely high. If you compare here, it's 600, and here it's 8 and 10. But there's no gradient anymore. So the cells get stimulated, but they don't know in which direction they have to go. Okay, and here we see this now as some temporal, combination of all the images of the real cell population, and here it's exactly the same population, but in the computer model, What we have seen that in the beginning they were all secreting the pheromone, so there was a lot of pheromone all over the place, and then they started secrete the protease bar 1, and you see they cleaved somehow some part of the pheromone, but there's still pheromone left, and so we see that there is some area here where we have pheromone and also where we have somehow nice gradients here. Yeah? And what we can see at the end is that more or less we have sharp gradients here, and when you look precisely here, we see also that there had been some successful cases of mating. Here, for example, you see this mixture here, successful mating, here cells could mate. So that means one can really see that the mating happens in these areas where we assume a very nice sharp gradient of the pheromone. Of course, they also need to see each other. Yeah? I mean, if they are too far away, then nothing can happen. There must be a certain density also. And so that also leads us to the idea that one can now also ask, what is the information that is contained in seeing alpha factor? Yeah, what does a cell really learn about that? And to that end, we can use this information concept from Channon. As you might remember, he had this idea that we have some kind of message. In that case, when Channon developed his concept, it was about telecommunication and just sending, like, say, electrical stimuli. Still, he wanted to know what the message is when there is some kind of noise. So we have a message and an encoder. We have a channel, and that channel is noisy. And finally, we have a decoder and the message at the end. And what we could have here is a ligand. So the ligand would here be our alpha factor, the receptor that we already looked at, the whole signaling pathway. The decoder would be, for example, the transcription factor and the message, the final transcriptional activity, whatever the cell can really measure and what it uses then to make a decision here. And as you might remember, what we need to do to calculate this, this kind of entropy and information is that we have some kind of random variable and we have a distribution of that random variable. And of course, then we would have a probability of observing this variable, and then Channon's entropy is calculated as the logarithm of this probability times the probability, and then we take the sum over that and have a minus in front of that. And then we would have two different variables, like y also, another distribution. So that could be, for example, the distribution of our input, and that could be the distribution of whatever the cell uses to interpret this, maybe the transcription factor. Then we can also look at conditional probabilities. So what is the probability of that input, given that we have an output y, or the other way around, probability of that output y, given that we have this input. We can look at joint probabilities. What is the probability of having both a certain amount of ligand and a certain amount of transcription factor activated? And when we push this a bit further, then of course we could calculate this entropy of Channon. We have the conditional entropy. So what is the entropy of the output given the input distribution that we have? And we can calculate this these probabilities here. And we can look at the mutual information. So what is the mutual information between these two compounds? And that would be now the entropy just for this variable x minus the conditional entropy. So minus what we have learned by observing them together. So what would be the idea? So we have here different values of input or different inputs. They all come with some kind of distribution. Then we have this noisy channel. So sensing with the receptor, transmitting with the signaling pathway, and then we get some kind of output. And of course, what one could do is then, of course, to simulate, let's say, with the different numbers of molecules and then obtain the different outputs. So that is a concept behind that, and we also tried to use this to understand what is actually the information that a cell gains out of the fact that it sees some pheromone here. And we can now do this also by, let's say, having this model in hand, which somehow reliably gives us the response of the cells that we have to simulate this for different scenarios. And that's what we have done here. Here is this more or less wild type scenario where we have used, let's say, two populations, one which is where the cells are very far from each other and one population where they are quite densely, to see what that gives. And using that concept that I just tried to introduce, we can now calculate the information content for cell when it sees an alpha factor. And this is plotted here, and what we have is here the population density and here the information content given by an alpha factor. And so what we see is when the population is not very dense, then also the information of seeing alpha factor molecules is not so high, but when the population gets more dense, then there is more and more information contained, but it also saturates at some point. But it means there is a lot of information. When we have the deletion mutant where this protease is no longer available, then we see actually that seeing a pheromone doesn't contain any information for the receiving cell anymore, yeah? Because they are just flooded and they cannot really conclude out of that whether the mating partner is close by and where it is, but they just know, okay, somewhere is someone. Okay, and here we can also look at the differences between the amount of mating factor sensed at the front and at the back of the cells, which is somehow related, but not exactly the same. But here again, we see when we have BAR1 deletion in this case here, then there is no difference anymore. That means if you, let's say, put these things together, that the cells can now really make, let's say, at least the wild type cells can now really make a very, let's say, important decision for their own life. So they can decide whether they either undergo mating or whether they just continue to grow. Yeah? So if the cells are dense and they feel the pheromone and they, let's say, sense that they have a chance to go and conjugate at the end, then they stop their cell cycle, they stop growing and prepare for mating and do this conjugation. But if they just don't feel enough of this alpha factor, they decide, I don't invest in that. I continue with my division and produce more new cells here, so in favor of the whole population. And if the cells have BAR1 deleted, then of course they are a little bit confused. They cannot really, in an informed way, make this decision. They stop their cell cycle, they try to mate, but they don't succeed here in that case. Good, we can also see this, let's say, what is the effect then on the population, on the growth of the population. We have both measured that in experiments, but we have also simulated this in the model here. Again, here the red cells are the MAT alpha cells, the white cells here are the MAT A cells. And we see that it is somehow also dependent on the density of the population, how successful the cells are. The more dense, the better is, of course, for the mating success. And what we see here in the experiments is when we have a very dense population, at least, then we can see that we have a lot of diploids after some time. So here the experiment starts, then we get the first set of diploids. But then, of course, as I said, the cells had been all synchronized in their cell cycle. If they didn't succeed here in the first round, they have to grow and divide again, and then in the second round, they can mate again. But it's better the denser the population than if it's a quite not dense population. And what we also see here is, again, essentially the same thing. The denser the population, the more diploids, the higher the total amount of the population is, also the more diploids we get. There was an interesting observation that we made here, that the two different mating times, MAT A and MAT alpha, are not dividing exactly the same. So obviously MAT A is a little bit faster. Yeah, it's not big, not much the difference here, but still it's very clear that they divide a little bit faster than MAT alpha cells, which is also interesting because actually they do not really differ a lot. I mean, they differ, they have a different transporter, and the pheromones look slightly different, but at the end it's the same kind of cell. Wild-type cells, I mean real wild-type cells somewhere out in the nature, they could even change their mating type. It's only the lab strains have been deleted. I mean, they are no longer able to change their mating types because one wants to have them in a pure version. That also makes us think a little bit about whether there can be some kind of cheating, whether cells can somehow make use of the other ones producing the protease. Here one has to consider that producing a protease, a protein actually, is of course quite expensive. And if the effect is so nice, maybe I can let the other ones do it. And so we also tried to look at what the effect of this one would be. So here the magenta cells are those that are cheating, so those ones which don't produce BAR1. So and what we have here is some kind of comparison of the growth of the cells in wild type. So what we would see if we have start with the same amount of A cells and alpha cells at 0 hours, then after 4 hours, we have a few more mat A cells, a bit more mat alpha cells, and a certain amount of diploid cells here, like 14%. If we instead would start with the cheater cells, the A cells here, and the alpha cells are normal ones, then after 4 hours, we also have some successful mating, some diploids, but as you can easily see, it's much less. So it's not completely excluded that they also mate, only the success is much smaller. And then we compared different mixtures of honest and cheater cells here, and we see that this, of course, somehow also affects the amount of diploids that we get. The message that we have at the end is very clear. So if we have only cheater cells and we have like 3% diploids after 4 hours, but if we have at least some honest cells here, that is like 5 or 6% honest cells, then we see that we can get more diploids here. We have 5.7 plus 0.3 means in total 6%, then we get more diploids. That means if at least a few cells make the efforts in producing BAR1, then of course the whole population is much better off, because at the end we get more diploids, and the diploids are simply stronger in dividing and providing a stronger, larger population. Okay, so this was about, let's say, what is the gradient around the cells. Now the next question is, of course, how is that stimulus sensed? What does a cell really do to sense it? And to that end, we can come here now to the signaling pathway. Again, now we can zoom in a little bit. Here's again, that is the membrane. That is this receptor. So it is a 7 transmembrane receptor here, so 7 alpha helixes go through the membrane, and here we have the alpha factor that's arriving, and when the alpha factor binds, then this so-called G protein undergoes some dynamics. It gets cleaved using some GDP, and then part of the G protein, G beta gamma, binds to other compounds. This is a so-called scaffold protein, STEF5, and then we have a MAP kinase cascade. And then this FAS3 is actually the one that gets phosphorylated and travels to the nucleus, where, as I said, it activates transcription of genes for stopping cell cycle. It activates this BAR1, for example, and it activates a lot of other components that are then really necessary for the mating. But this whole thing also binds to other compounds like CDC42, CDC24, and so on, forming this kind of polarization spot there. Mm-hmm. Okay, was that the question? No. Okay, so CDC42, as it says here, is a small rho GTPase that determines the direction of the growth then at the end of the day. Okay, so we have these two things. Again, we have the signaling into the nucleus, and we have the formation of this polarization spot, and that's what we want to understand. Maybe we skip this here for a second, although that would be also interesting. Let's continue with the diffusion. the space. So what we have now is a cell, and as we saw it before, we have the receptors in the outer surface of the cell, and the receptor, of course, can also diffuse within this outer surface, and it can diffuse together with the whole polarization spot. And then the signal goes into the cell itself, and there it should reach the nucleus, but there's also other components, for example, the vacuole. And that means we have to consider the diffusion once in these two dimensions on the surface and in three dimensions within the cytosol of the cell. And that's what we can do then, is when we have some kind of component, we see that it can move here in the membrane, so there is some diffusion within the membrane. Oops, that should be the diffusion here. We have an exchange between membrane and the other compounds, and we have the stimulation actually by the alpha factor. And then in the volume, of course, we also have just the diffusion. Again, we have boundary conditions on the membrane that we have this exchange here with the internal kind, and we have the stimulation, and we also have boundary conditions for the diffusion within the volume. And of course, we need to define some initial conditions. For this exchange and the dynamics here at the membrane, there have been already formulated a number of models how one could explain this kind of polarization. And we have also tried to make use a little bit. One is a so-called wave painting model that has formulated a function, or an expression for this function here. Another model is from Goyachin. The general idea is always that we have some kind of local activation and global inhibition that then typically leads to some kind of spot formation here. But it depends then at the end of the day on the molecular details. I would like to focus on what I show afterwards only on this model formulated here from Goyachin. So, What we can discuss here, first of all, is what is the role of the shape of that object that we look at, and also what is the role of, let's say, where the different signals come from. And what we see here, first of all, is that we compare the shapes of our object. So what we have here is a perfect sphere that we look at, and we also assume that the signal that the sphere can sense is completely homogeneously distributed around the cell. What would be the effect? The effect is, of course, that there is no polarization at all, at least as long as we have some kind of deterministic model, no polarization, and that means the signal is sensed at all points exactly the same. Now we assume that we have already something like this shmoo shape here, and again we have a homogeneous signal around this cell. Then the result was, at least for us, a little bit surprising, is that the activation appears here, or the polarization appears here down at the bottom, so that at this bigger part of the cell at the base, it does not appear here in this in the shmoo, in the tip, where we actually would like to have it, because that's where the cell has to grow to. That's not the case. When we saw this, we even compared what would happen if we have a slightly stronger stimulus coming from the top end here compared to the bottom end, and that's still just a slightly different, a slightly stronger signal would not really help. So then we would still have some kind of polarization here at the end. We really need a very clear, strong signal to get the polarization here at the tip. Of course, if we would just have a sphere like here and have a stronger signal here as one on the tip, then we see, of course, there the polarization appears. Things change immediately when we have some diffusion barriers in the cell. And of course, the cell has a lot of diffusion barriers. One is still coming from the scar that the mother has left. So when the two cells divide, then of course there's always a little bit of scar, and this already inhibits the diffusion. And as I also said, as we saw in one of the pictures, there is this butt neck, and that also might inhibit diffusion. And when we have now a signal coming from here, which is slightly stronger, or they can be even the same, Then suddenly we have a polarization here, or we get a higher concentration of this polarization spots here, which is somehow indicated here by this blue curve. If we have only a polarization, some diffusion barrier on one side, so at least something here, then we also see that there is some localization here at this point. So that already helps, but it wouldn't help if both the signals are the same and there is no diffusion barrier. Okay, if we now look at this in 2D, then we can also see that organelles within the cell might have a quite severe effect. So this is now again the scenario that we have a perfectly round cell, perfectly homogeneous signal around the cell, and then here nucleus perfectly centered in the middle of the cell. Then we would see, okay, the gradient is not very high, but we would see, okay, there's an activation directly at the surface within going into this the cell. There's, let's say, a decay of the signal, but still it's perfectly round. If we have a nucleus that is no longer perfectly in the middle, but somehow more at the boundary of the cell, then we suddenly see that also has an influence on the diffusion of the stimulus within the cell, and we suddenly see that we have some kind of higher concentration of the active compounds here behind that. If you would have even here the vacuole more focused, more shielding somehow that part of the membrane, we would also obtain more stimulus at that point. Good, what we then need when we try to simulate those things, especially with different shapes, is of course, up to now, we more or less considered only that we have just this diffusion. But what we now also need to include is that we have to triangulate the surface and put some kind of meshes over these surfaces so that one can really calculate the diffusion within these shapes. I mean, and the round shape would be still okay, but then as soon as the shapes change, we need this. What is then done is using this kind of finite element method. So look at these different triangles. There is a number of tools out that one can use here. My student has used Dune, but there's other ones like Phoenix and so on that one can use to calculate these things. One more aspect also for this polarization is the question of the size of the cell. Question is whether that actually makes a difference for the cells. And what we can see here on these simulations is that they need a minimum size to polarize actually, if the cells are too small here. So that is just 1 micrometer. That would be too small. The real cells are between 2 to 5, I mean, they're a little bit like this, small cells like 2 micrometer, then 5, 6 micrometers long. and what we see here is in the simulation on a cell that is slightly bigger, and you see here we have an even bigger cell, and we can see, okay, there is some kind of intermediate size where the cells are able to polarize very quickly after they get some stimulus, and then when they get even bigger, they still polarize, but it takes them much longer. You see, we have here these different patches, and only after about 700 seconds, they really decide for one side where it's polarized. Up to that, they really have to have the competition between these different areas that can polarize. Okay, that is not really perfect. Now, when we look back at this signaling pathway, as I said, we have this kind of MAP kinase signaling pathway, where parts of the components are bound to the membrane and form complexes over there, and part of the components have this cascade in the cytoplasm, where we have protein binding and unbinding, phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. And the question is also how much or what the impact is of this binding to the membrane. And what we wanted to look at here is this kind of classical MAP kinase cascade. Here we have the receptor binding the ligands. Then we have the first phosphorylation, dephosphorylation, second phosphorylation, dephosphorylation, and that one also phosphorylates, dephosphorylates, goes into the nucleus. I'm sorry for the bad quality here. So that would be part of this whole cascade here that we see here, and part of that is bound to the membrane. And now we can look at two different scenarios. One scenario is where more of these compounds, when we look at the simplified version here, not this complicated one, here we have, let's say, two steps happening at the membrane, and only the third step goes into the cytoplasm and then nucleus. Or we look at the full cascade being in the cytoplasm, transporting the compound here. Again, when we would have some kind of structure, we use the same system of partial differential equations as before. We have the first component being at the membrane. It can diffuse at the membrane, be phosphorylated and dephosphorylated. The same for the second component, diffuse, phosphorylated, dephosphorylated. And the third component is then in the cytosol. It can diffuse in the cytosol and can also be then deactivated. And we need, of course, boundary conditions at the membrane that the third component can bind and unbind to the membrane, and it can also be sucked into the nucleus and then there deactivated. Okay, that was for this kind of model here. And what we then can see, I mean, when we now compare these two different scenarios that we have, when we have here this scenario where more of the molecules are bound to the membrane, is that we then have, first of all, a dependence on the size of the cell, but also that we can see a nice gradient. When we have a very small cell, then we see an immediate activation over the whole volume, more or less. When the cell is getting bigger and bigger, we see that there is a gradient, and it's not so much concentration, active concentration, really getting to the nucleus, but still it happens, but there's a gradient. When we have this purely cytosolic cascade, where we don't have much compounds bound to the membrane, then we see that we always get a more or less equal distribution, not completely, but more or less equal distribution in the cell. It's still depending on the radius of the cell, on the size of the cell, but this nice gradient that we have here in this mixed cascade gets somehow missing. And that argues a little bit, I mean, that there is obviously a very specific role for this high formation of complexes at the membrane that the cell really needs is also to, let's say, manage the gradients that are forming within the cell. Then there has been another observation. What I now reported to is that we have these two cells, they want to mate, so they form a shmoo. But what people have found is when they just have these cells that don't have bar one, so that after a while, when they don't get successful, they stop making this shmoo bigger and bigger, but instead they start to have a second shmoo, and that's what we see here. So they start to have the second protrusion here that is growing, and after a while, if even that is not successful, they start with the third protrusion. And of course, then we can again go and try to make this kind of meshes to describe the surface, and also using that as the basis for the simulations. And we can also look in a, let's say, more stochastic model, what kind of polarization spots we would get. Again, here, when we have the perfectly round cell that is stimulated with pheromone all over the place, so in homogeneous stimulation, then when we would just look where the polarization spot appears over the angle, and here then we see it's distributed all over the place, more or less equally. If we would have a cell that looks a little bit like an oval cell, so that is not really a sphere anymore, then we see, okay, the primary spot for the polarization is here on the top, so on the longer side of the cell, which is also then given by the, let's say, distribution of polarization spots over the cell. As soon as we have already this kind of shmoo form, we see that the next polarization spot, and here it's becoming more and more clear where it should be from the stochastic simulation, the next polarization spot is about 120 degrees from the first shmoo away. And then if you have these two shmoos already, then the third spot is here at the bottom of the cell, again, these 120 degrees away. So that means there is some kind of likelihood where the next shmoo appears depending on the shape that the cell already has. And as I said, one can also really see that under the microscope here. And then depending on the shape that the cell actually has, we can also see that the distribution of the signal within the cell also changes. Yeah, we had here the perfect sphere already. The perfect sphere, then we have this kind of rod-shaped version. Then we see here that we have more polarization at the end of this rod-shaped curve. If we have one shmoo, then we would have here the activation. And if we have the two shmoos, we see higher concentrations inside here at these two protrusions of the cell. That is now, as it says here, for the last tier of the signaling cascade, so that would be this FAS3 that then is actually supposed to go into the nucleus and report to the nucleus that now transcription should start for the different compounds. How am I doing with time? I still have a few minutes?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Good, then the last question was, how do the cells actually now change their shape? Sorry, maybe I should drink some water. Okay, again, we have this scenario that they want to find each other and change shape. What we now wanted to consider is in some kind of static version, this model of the cell where we have, let's say, four different areas. We have here the tip area, then we have some kind of shaft, we have the neck, and here we have the back of the cell. And what we need to consider is here that the cells actually have some togo pressure inside. Now, as I told you, there is a cell wall. We have typically lower osmotic pressure outside of the cell and higher osmotic pressure inside the cell. And the difference of the two is the togo pressure that really pressures against the cell wall. And what we then try to calculate is just for such a kind of shape, what are different quantities describing the elasticity of the cell here, stress and strain. And what we can see is that they are not equally distributed, even if we have some kind of basic parameters that are all the same. And we tried to use, this is just coming out of the calculation of seeing the cells. Maybe I should go to the next slide in order to introduce the different measures that we have. So here, as I said, we have the cell wall. We have the togo pressure of the cell that is somehow related to some kind of a measure of the cells, but also then given by P. And then one quantity that we have to consider is a strain. So that is just the relative expansion that the cell feels when it has to change its shape. And we have the stress, sigma, and stress is here the force that is applied per area of the cell. And actually, we have on the one hand the meridional both strains here and the meridional stress. So along the, along the meridian here. And we have the circumferential strain and stress that we have to consider. This case here are the Hauptkrümmung. I'm sorry, it will come back later. Hauptkrümmung, somebody German? Can help. The curvatures, the main curvatures of the shapes here in the meridional and in the circumferential directions of the cell. So that means, in principle, if you know the togo pressure, we can calculate the stress and the strains of the cells, and that's what we have done here. And so we can somehow represent them over the surface of the cell. What we also have here is a so-called Young's modulus, which represents the elasticity of the cell here. So what you have seen before was just, let's say, a simulation for the shape if the shape is given. We wanted then to understand whether that is really the case, that the cell looks like this. And what we did to this extent was using atomic force microscopy. What one does in atomic force microscopy is that one uses a cantilever and just pokes into the cell is somehow trapped here in some kind of little hole, one pokes the cell and just records the force that is necessary to poke the cell then with some kind of laser light. And so what we have here, if the cantilever is approaching the surface, then of course we don't need any force, but as soon as it touches the surface, and goes in, the force increases and increases. So that's what we see here. So no force, but when it touches, we have some force. And that's what we use actually to measure the elasticity of the cell. And that's what we see here. We see this Young's module that is representing this elasticity. And we see that they are more or less, if we just have a normal cell, that is the height here, they are more or less have the same elasticity all over the place. It's a little bit of shadow here. You must imagine, of course, the cantilever, there is some kind of hidden area around the cell just from geometrical reasons. If we would have a cell that already is stimulated with alpha factor and starts to shmoo, we can easily see that it's coming a bit out of the plane, yeah, that it's somehow growing towards us. And we immediately see that there are some changes in the elasticity of the cell. Yeah, so that there is some kind of, here it is a little bit more or less, here it's a bit more stiff, here it's a bit more stiff, and here it's suddenly a little bit more elastic. So that means around the neck, there appears some kind of elasticity in the cells. And we have measured that systematic for many cells, and we see, okay, it's more stiff at the tip, it's more stiff at the base, and more elastic here at this shaft. When we look at a number of cells. Actually, that's a quite laborious kind of testing of cells. You have to wait many hours to get a lot of different cells counted here. Okay, so what we see, cell wall softens at the emerging mating projection, except of the tip. The tip is quite stiff here, what we see. And this is now, let's say, combined a lot of images from this atomic force microscopy. So a cell that has been growing out of here. What you see here is still this birth or bud scars that the cell had before. So they also can be seen, of course, and then we see the mating projection coming out here of the surface towards the solution. Of course, here is some kind of shadow again. If the cantilever comes here from the top, that cannot be recorded really. Okay, and as again, we need this kind of triangulation of the surface, and especially if the cell changes its shape here now, then of course we have to change that. It's two different ways. If we would start with some kind of equal triangle here, then we can on the one hand have some kind of elastic deformation of the different sides, but we can also have some kind of plastic growth, which is then really implemented, and then also add some kind of elastic deformation for these different compounds. Bringing this together, we can then look at the different cells, and here we have used different, let's say, slightly different versions of the model that we have implemented, but in all the cases we had implemented the idea that there must be some more elastic part at the shaft of the butt neck, and here in this case we have considered no growth, and then it's actually what you see. I mean, when we have this elasticity here, the stronger elasticity, we see that the cells can create some shapes, as I said, slightly different for the different versions of the model, the precise formulation, but there is no formation of a shmoo if we don't allow the cell to have this softer surface there. And we can also record different properties here, which probably doesn't make so much sense here. Okay, and then we have tried to challenge this model a little bit. One experiment that is frequently done with yeast cells is that one exposes them to osmotic stress. And osmotic stress means that one simply adds some salt to the environment, and so all the water flows out of the cells shrink. And now we try to combine this with the shmooing. So here we have a cell that has already shmooed. It's in a microfluidic device, normally with some normal medium, and then we change to a medium that has not salt, but sorbitol. And what we then see is that the cell actually shrinks. And that's also what you can see here in the movie. So that's a point where it shrinks. And then we were looking whether the model that we had can also explain how this shrinking actually happens. And what we have here, the gray shadow is the cell before the osmotic shock, and the blue is the cell after the osmotic shock. And it can quite nicely, let's say, recover the shape changes that we see here. And it actually also helped us a little bit to re-estimate the toga pressure that the cells have inside. We changed it a little bit from some higher value. It's still in the order of the pressure that you have in the tire of your bike. So it's quite impressive how high the pressure is in these cells. Okay, now there's of course still a lot of open questions that we have at that point. One of the open questions is actually how this softening of the neck of the cells actually appear and which protein might be responsible for that. There is some candidates that people have mentioned in the literature. By now we don't know actually. What we have tried to test is what different mutants would make to the shape of the cell here. So that is just BAR1, our protease. So if we would have just BAR1, it can be activated and we get this kind of average shape of the cell. If we would also, let's say, delete other candidates that people have mentioned, we get similar shape. Nothing of that really indicates, yeah, this is the protein that is responsible. I'm almost done. That is responsible for the shape changes. We are still looking for that, and that's some kind of open thing. But this is now, let's say, bringing all the different aspects that we had together in one simulation. So this is now cells that are secreting pheromone. Then, as you can see, they try to polarize. They polarize, and then they change their shape. And up to now, it's going to touch each other. Here we can also do this now for more cells. These are now 9 cells. And as you can see, when we bring together these 9 cells, it also depends, of course, on the position of a cell, where it will orient, and whether it's successful or not. I mean, so this comes too late here. And one can really nicely play around with these different opportunities where the cells can meet and what the conditions would be to be successful in some kind of mixture of different cells. And last not least, the next step is, of course, looking what will really happen at the mating. So what we had up to now was these 2 cells approaching each other. At the end, they will form this kind of zygote, so some kind of huntel shape, like this here, and we would like to try to find out now what the the elasticity in this membrane or in this cell wall now is, how that changes over time. We are currently again doing experiments where we use FRET, or first resonance energy transfer, to see what actually changes and over the surface here, how the different compounds are distributed and what the elasticity is. Okay, and with that, I'm more or less at the end. What I tried to convince you is that one can, of course, simulate processes in 3 dimension and in the time. What we had here was, first of all, the pheromone gradient that is, let's say, established as a population property, so all the different cells somehow contribute this. We had the gradient sensing and the implementation in the sense that we have this polarization of the cell as a 3-dimensional modeling. We had the shape changes, shape and cell wall elasticity, and the shape calculations with this spring model. We integrated the sensing and the shmooing in one model, and we integrated also the communication between the open cells, between the different cells. And what is still open is, of course, to really simulate the actual mating event between two cells in this kind of population. Okay, I would not like to finish without thanking people. Person who has done most of the work is Wolfgang here, Wolfgang Giese, who is now also at the Max Delbrück Center, and Björn Goldenbogen. Wo ist Björn? Nee. He escaped. I will find him. Björn Goldenbogen, yeah, at least his name is here, has done a lot of the experiments also and some of the simulations. Yeah. And now I'm happy to take your questions.